You know, I know this time of year, to be thankful for a warm house.
Yeah.
You know, a car that runs, clothes.
Yeah.
You know, I spent today a lot of time outside, and I was just thankful that you're able to do that. You know, you have the strength and, you know, the wind whipping across there. But, you know, there's always something to be thankful for.
Amen.
You know, sometimes we look at life and look at our circumstances, and we don't know what's going on. But one thing about it, we know one thing, God is good. And God is always there.
Amen.
Psalms 43, I want to read a few verses and a few of Psalm 44. And verse 3 of Psalm 43 says, "Oh, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Then will I go to the altar of God, to God my exceeding joy. Yes, with the lyre will I praise you, O God, my God. Why are you cast down, O my inner self? Why should you moan over me and be disquieted within me? Hope in God and wait expectantly for him, for I shall yet praise him, who is the help of my sad countenance and my God." And I go to verse 44. "We have heard with our ears, O God, our fathers have told us what work you did in their days, in the days of old. You drove out the nations with your hand, and it was your power that gave Israel a home by rooting out the heathen peoples, but Israel you spread out. For they got not in the land of Canaan in possession by their own sword, neither did their own arm save them, but your right hand, your arm, and the light of your countenance did it, because you were favorable toward and did delight in them. You are my king, O God, command victories and livers for Jacob, Israel."
Yes.
One thing I love that how David and how a lot of the Bible, you know, David, he made it personal.
Yeah.
See, that's where it has to be with God. It has to be personal. When Jesus asked disciples, "Who do you say that I am? How powerful?" You know, a lot of people can say this and that, but who do you? It's a personal thing. Well, you have to decide who Jesus is in your life, because Jesus can change your life. And the thing, I love it, for I shall yet praise him. And sometimes, you know, we can get circumstance in our life and it's hard to praise, but get it started. Psalm 34:1 says, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth." I love that scripture because it tells me a lot. If praise, you know, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth." That does not leave any room for complaining. That does not leave any room for doubt. When we start praising God and start seeking him, you know, I know I say that often when I get up here, but the one thing I feel God wants us to do more than anything is just to trust him and believe him. That's all. It's like, that's why he was always amazed when somebody actually did that. When somebody believed him.
Yeah.
That's all he ever wanted.
Yeah.
You know, God is so powerful. Sometimes we make our problems bigger than God. How can that possibly be?
Right.
How can that possibly be? When God knew you before he was in your mom's belly. Think about that. And he's weaving your personality. I often say to people, why are you alive at this point in history? Because you could have been born in the 1700s.
Sure.
You could have been born in the 1600s. Because God has a plan for you right now.
Yeah.
He has a plan for your life. You're never too old. I mean, you think about Moses. He didn't get things going until he was 80 years old.
Right.
He didn't get things going. So we got a lot of life yet.
Yeah.
You know, I remember years ago a preacher, he was at a church, I believe it was up in Michigan. He says, I want you to come downstairs and see my furnace. The furnace operates this church. It's the big church. You know who it was? It was these prayer warriors down there. That's who the furnace was. It was these people down there praying. See, that's one thing I really do love about people that can really get a hold of God. And sometimes it's them older saints. They can't do much else in the church in that sense, but they can pray for you. And them old mothers that got down, because we used to have the altar call a lot at a church when I grew up. And they didn't worry about time. You know, they would tarry down at that altar. And they would pray. I remember going to church. I was just thinking about the other day. You know, it was nothing to spend 2 or 3 hours there. You know, but we didn't worry about time. because we knew we was going to meet God. It wasn't just when I was little. I remember people said a lot of times, you know, not just where you go to church at, where do you go to worship at? I remember that part coming out a lot. Where do you worship at? You know, because that's what it was about. It was about going to the house of God and worshiping Him and praising Him and not feel afraid to declare God.
Amen.
You know, there's sometimes, you know, I in a profession that I know in seconds life can change. I'm in that profession. But I know one thing, above that profession is God.
Yeah.
So I can pray over that situation.
Yeah.
I know I shared a little bit of it a Sunday, but you know, we had a truck broke down and it broke down on the yard, which was good. We was getting ready to take it out Friday night. That was God. You know, I said, if this truck does this one more time, got it moving a little bit, does one more time, we're done. I said, that's a blessing right there, because it could have broke down between here and Waterloo.
Right.
And we had the guys in the truck. Then you got to get a wrecker. You got to get all that. It's pretty cold. And try to pile everybody in the other truck, not going to work. So sometimes when things don't go well, that's still God protecting you. You know, sometimes we think, oh, if God, you know, I don't know why God's saying no, no, no to this. You know, and I tell people a lot of times, because they get frustrated, well, man, I really wanted this place. I really wanted to work here. I said, you know what? When all them doors are shut, when all them no's tell you something, God's got something better for you.
Yes.
And when God brings you something better, it's better than you can even imagine.
Right.
That's what I found out through my life, that it's better. Sometimes it seems disappointing. Oh, I didn't get this appointment. I didn't get that. Okay, hold on. It doesn't mean God's through. It doesn't mean. Sometimes, you know, we look at the reason some people don't pray to God about certain situations, because they're afraid He might say no.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, God's wise enough. Even if it's no, His no's going to be better than He would say yes to you at that time. Because sometimes you can give the person the right thing at the wrong time, you know, that he can't take. But God is wise enough. Why don't you seek God first? My sister and I talk about that. I said we need to pray God before the fact rather than after the fact. We go ahead and get into some situation and then ask God to get us out. You know,
yeah.
I see that all the time.
Yeah.
Get us out. Wouldn't it have been better if we would got on our knees and said, God, do you want me to do this?
Yeah.
Said someone would get afraid because he might say no. So that's all right. He's trying to protect you.
Yes.
You know, why don't you give a 5-year-old a driver's license? You know, I mean, some of them are probably big enough they physically could drive a little car, right? But you know, they don't have the judgment to be able to understand all the traffic laws. That's why in Iowa you wait till they get 14 and they can come along, you know, and get the permit and stuff so they grow up there.
Right.
Same way as Christians, you know, God brings us along in steps. We should be a lot farther in Christ every year. You know, we should be bolder and bigger in Christ because we're understanding it more. You know, you take a Christian who's only been saved a year. You know, what I love about them is their enthusiasm. You know, is that they want to share with everybody they meet. You know, and then what kind of happens, sometimes they kind of taper off. But they don't have a tendency to taper off if they get with a good, devout Christian that helps them come along in those times of discouragement. That takes the time to read the Bible to them. Takes the time to pray and join and lock arms and say, brother, you know, we all went through it. I had a good Christian friend and he was kind of fired up, but he always felt, you know, he come and whisper to me, he says, Tim, man, I feel like I'm gonna die any day. You know, he always worried about death. I said, yeah, we go through that stuff, but you know what? Paul said, just think about it. To die is gain.
Yeah.
So you can't lose. We need to stop worrying about dying.
Mm-hmm.
You need to start worrying about living.
That's right.
And living for Christ, because we don't know if this is our last day. We don't know that. You know, we can't decide that. I mean, and it's God can say, hey, tell you what, it's time to come home. But until that day, we need to be working for His cause and praying for His cause. And I tell you what, we should never give up on people.
That's right.
We should never know. You know, one time, the missus and I, we often talk about what your last word should be to somebody. Think about that. Would you want them to be arguing and then they have a heart attack? And that's the last memory they have of you, is you was arguing with them. You know, or would it be the best thing if they can remember about you? You told me I loved you.
Right.
I love you. You know, that makes a good issue. And I'm going to close with this But I know I probably said it before, but one day we was just talking about that billion words. I want you to think about that. If from the time you could speak when you were a baby, you start to form words, and you only get 1 billion words in your entire life. Now, that's not very many words when we think about it in a lifetime,
right.
You know, but just think about it. And after that billionth word, you could not speak anymore. Mm. Now, think about that. Wouldn't that make your words count? Wouldn't you stop using idle words or think about it? Because you know when that last one spoke, that's it. You can never speak again. You know, and I think that God wants us to be encouraging to people, you know, rather than to call them names or we don't know the circumstances they've been through. We don't know that. Well, I don't know. That guy's acting. We don't know what they've been through. That kid's acting up here. We don't know. Rather than criticize, once you pray for that individual, you know, there's not too many people in my entire life that I said, hey, I'm going to pray for you. They said, I don't appreciate you praying for me. I don't get that response. You know, I get just the opposite. Thank you. Thank you for praying for me. That's what I get. I don't care. The hardest people I ever see, you know, they appreciate that you're praying for them and you're believing. Because you know what? When you take time to get a hold of God, because I tell you what, I know on Facebook and follow me on there, I always put prayers up. I just started putting that probably a couple years. I just write those two words because I don't believe my prayers stop here at the ceiling.
Right.
I mean, I can go up to the throne room. You know, they reach up there to heaven. Like that incense, the prayers of the saints, it goes up. And I believe God Almighty is going to do something. I mean, it'd be kind of, you're going to pray and then not believe God, it's going to come true. So we're wasting a little time. Yeah. Let's really believe it. You know, sometimes you help unbelief, but I'm going to just keep praying and keep praying and keep believing. You know, you never stop. You don't ever give up. Thief on the cross, the one that repented. You know he had a grandma, a mom praying for him for years. And he cut it pretty close. That's what I'm saying that. He was about going out. But you know what? You could tell. And I know I say this a lot, but folks, it's just so true. You know, you got that old grandma, you know, washing her clothes in the bucket. She's washing it. You know, Lord, I don't know where my grandson is, but Lord, save him, save him, save him, save him. You know, and their tears are going from her face down into the water bucket. And their mom's flat on the floor. I don't know where my son is, but save him, save him, save him. Now, that person did not have a chance to learn evangelism explosion and all Roman roadmap.
Yes.
But how many people has he led to Christ because he repented that last time? And all he said, remember me. Remember me. He didn't say, well, I did this, 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 this. Remember me, Lord. Remember me. And Jesus said, Jesus had enough going on at that time.
Yeah.
You know, he could have been said, but he wasn't. This day. I love that. You know, he didn't have this long speech to say, you know, son, I think, you know, let's think about this. You didn't waste your whole. He didn't say none of that.
Right.
This day, you're going to be with me. See? This day, right now, everything's taken care of. I mean, you're going out of this world, but you're going to go into the next one,
yeah.
And you're going to spend eternity with me. Because see what? I didn't give up on you.
Right.
And there's other people didn't give up on you.
Right.
Lord, let's tonight we're just going to praise God. So we're going to open this up, and I just want to thank God for being God.
Amen.
Just being God. Yes, Roberto.
Holy Spirit moves, and people that don't know who God is. that connection, I gave all of that to come here to dwell with you, to tell you how good it is, so that when it's time for you to go, you can be there with me enjoying the same thing.
Amen.
And that we have that revelation and others around us can see that, and that it's put in their hearts, of the hunger and the curiosity that they have starts opening, and God can move through that door, and lives continue to be changed.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you. That's so true. That's what it's about. I mean, it just, yeah, just, yes.
Yeah, Suzanne got a call late last night. One of her bosses is turning their two-week notice. So we were up pretty late last night, but she's really stressing because her workload's going to almost like triple with this other boss leaving. And she's, you know, she's just concerned about the other time. I'm already working so many hours now, and it's just such a big workload. And so she was supposed to leave this morning, and she didn't leave till this afternoon. She's flew out to Detroit for this conference with this Midwest group that she works with. So I just wanted, you know, to give her, you know, pray to give her peace, that they'll figure out how to put all these clients with the right people and within her office. And her boss has kind of told her, well, it's time for you to step up, and looks like you'll get your promotion early next year. So she's really stressing it, and I just want to lift her up, that, you know, to give her peace,
yes,
and give her,
yes,
you know,
yes,
that she'll be able to do everything that they want her to do, and,
mm-hmm,
and not, you know, not have to work an 80-hour work week, you know. So
right.
Well,
yep. We'll definitely pray, and that's what the body is for.
Yes.
Pray one for another. Yes.
I'd like to pray for healing for two of my nephews, Kirk and Jason,
mm-hmm,
and also for Allison and her family. They're all dealing with some old issues and stuff. But these two young guys are only in their 40s, and both of them are dealing with cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So God is more than able. I just sent an email back to my sister-in-law. But, you know, for the families that are closest to those situations, just like what you were saying tonight, Tim, and likewise with Myron, and I just talked to him before church tonight, and I tried to tell him the same thing that you were saying, and that the focus has to remain on Jesus. We have to see him as bigger than the issue.
That's right.
The problem, no matter how big the issue might be. And I know that it's easy to say that, or it seems that way to somebody who's going through it, and then you just give them that advice, but that's the only advice we have. It's the truth. And so let's just pray that not only does God move in these situations, but the people see that it is God, that they understand that God is their answer. And
exactly.
For Myron, just a heads up for those of you that are here tonight, we'll probably take up an offering of some kind for him Sunday. He's depressed, obviously, with the holidays coming and the work and all that. So we'll do what we can physically, but most importantly, we need to just continue to hold him up and all of these needs.
That's right.
And for all of these people. So
yeah.
Remember that tonight.
Amen.
Yeah, but and that's what the church is for.
In fact, I thought the scriptures that you read were ideal for Myron. I mean, it just spoke directly to the situation that he's going through right now. But you have the will to praise the Lord. You have to make a decision to do it, because your body's telling you everything else, but your heart and your mind is trying to connect with God.
Yeah.
We can't get a breakthrough without it.
Yeah.
You just can't. I mean, God is depending on us to believe. Even as weak as our faith might be at times, it's still enough if we can just believe.
Yeah. And thanks for sharing. And that's really what it takes. You know, I come to work in the morning, and I listen to Christian radio, but I got a lot of devotions on my phone. I go through them, you know, and they speak to me every morning, you know. And I was on the drive, and they read Psalms 43 today on the radio. And when that verse, "For I shall yet praise him." I mean, that's what it is. I mean, it's just praising him. And sometimes it's a groan until you start praising God and seeing how big God is in that situation.
Yeah.
Sometimes we make the problem so big. You know, when Jesus said, his name's above every name.
Amen.
That's above cancer.
Yeah.
You know, that's above heartache. You know, it's above all of our trials. And we can't forget that. We cannot forget that. Yes, Mike.
Thank you all for praying for Cindy. She went and had some oral surgery done yesterday. She's dealing with some swelling, a little bit of pain and stuff right now, but for the most part, she's coming through it really well. And naturally, it affected her heart rate and her breathing through the day and stuff like that, but supernaturally, Lord sustaining her and believing for her total recovery and healing. So I appreciate your prayers and thank God for his hand being upon her right now.
Yes. Yep. Okay. Well, let's go ahead and go to prayer, please, if you stand. Father God,
Jesus,
we thank you tonight that we can come and praise you. We thank you for our body of believers that believe you. The situation, Suzanne, and all the work and all that, that you would work it all out. That you're more than able to work it out. And Lord, to give her the help that she needs. I know sometimes we can feel so stressed, but we're supposed to cast all our care upon you, because you care for us. Oh, let us not be anxious for anything. Oh, Father God, we want to thank you tonight. Oh, be with Roberto's request, Lord, that Father God, that this Christmas season, not just about gifts and holly and all that, but about Jesus, about you, that people need to see that light. They need to understand what this life is all about. Hallelujah. And it's about serving Christ. Oh, Father God, Lord, we ask you to be with the prayer requests of the pastor, the young men, hallelujah, the cancer issue. But you are above cancer. You are above that situation. Lord, we ask you to be with Myron. Be with Cindy. Be with all our health needs in this congregation. Because, God, I just keep saying, more than able. You're more than able. More than able. Hallelujah. You are a wonderful Father, our wonderful Counselor. Hallelujah. Mighty Father. Hallelujah. You are mighty. Pulling down on strongholds. Hallelujah. For I shall yet praise him. And Lord, that's what we want to do tonight. Praise you. Father God, that you would be with all of our church families, Lord. That you would watch over them through the spell of cold weather. Keep their furnaces going. Keep their homes going. Keep all the needs that they have. Lord, that you would meet every need tonight. Father God, oh, I just keep seeing that more than able, you are more than able to handle every need that we have. There is nothing, as the Bible said, there is nothing too hard for thee. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The Bible says, for with God, all things are possible. It doesn't say it's some things. It doesn't say a few things. It's for with God all things are possible. And Lord, tonight we're going to bring this request to you. And we thank you, Lord, that we can take these requests clear right up to the throne room. And Lord, that you would move on these requests and concerns. Father God, we thank you for coming down. Hallelujah. Jesus, you came down as a baby. You were always a king. Oh, Father God, let us never forget that. Never forget where you have brought us from and where you are taking us. Because, Lord, it's all about you. Let us never forget it. As we go further into the service, that, Lord, you would touch our hearts. Said Ezekiel, will you create that clean heart, that new heart? Because it's all about you. Oh, Father God, let us never forget you. Let us never forget all the blessings that you have blessed us with already and the ones that are coming along the way. Father God, thank you that we are engraved on your hand. That's how dear we are to you. I ask you to put your arms around everybody here, those ones that cannot be here tonight, that you would watch over them. And we want to thank you. And we want to praise you tonight in your wonderful holy name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. Did you turn off your cell phone?
and put it on vibrate if you would, please. Okay, now we're going to speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Hallelujah. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Brother Ron, would you be so kind and come up and take the offering, please? Thank you.
Appreciation, give back a portion of your kingdom. God, I ask you. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, we just thank you tonight for what you've already done, for the prayers that have already been answered. We thank you, Lord, for the manifestation that will come, for the testimonies that will result in what you've done already this evening, Lord. We just bless you, Lord. You are a great and a mighty God. Lord, there's none like you, and you alone are God. And we worship and praise you. We love you, Lord, because you first loved us and gave us the capacity to love, the desire to love you, the hunger to know you. We thank you tonight, Lord. We praise you. We praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. God bless you all. You may be seated. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Tim. Appreciate the opening, sharing with us a great word. It's good to have Roberto up here again. Thank the Lord. Good to have you back. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Mike, for everything. Praise God. You know what they say? An apple a day will keep anyone away if you throw it hard enough. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now I'm getting older and sometimes I question my sanity, but the unicorn in our kitchen told me I'm fine, so it's all good. Praise the Lord. I'll be all right. Praise the Lord. All right, hallelujah. Well, after the prayer requests we've heard tonight and some of the ongoing situations, I think it's never wrong to remind us how much our confidence in God is necessary. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And you know, the tiniest amount of faith, I think sometimes people think that because they're struggling with, you know, an ongoing situation, that their faith isn't enough. Well, just like what Tim said tonight, if you will to praise the Lord, that's faith. That's making a decision, a rational decision, based on an irrational situation. You're choosing to put your confidence in God. God honors that. And that's something we need to constantly remind ourselves, because the devil will come along and tell you, oh, you don't have enough faith. You don't have enough. Listen, if you're believing God, whatever faith you've got will be enough. He's given us a measure of faith, the faith to believe him, to trust him, no matter what the situation or the circumstance is. So with that in mind, let's go to Ephesians chapter 1, and I'd like to read verses 1 through 7, Roberto. Ephesians 1, verses 1 through 7. Appreciate y'all coming out tonight in the cold and being here to worship the Lord and make him part of our Wednesday night. Hallelujah. He's part of every day of our lives, but it doesn't hurt to remind him and one another that he's important enough for us to make a sacrifice and be here to do that, to honor him. Amen. So Paul's writing, he says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. So there's no better teacher than Jesus when it comes to the problems of life. He had more problems than any of us, and he came out victorious. God loves to bring blessings out of what looks like curses. And I say what looks like a curse, because what starts out as a curse doesn't have to remain one. I've noticed something over the years, and that is that problems always precede miracles. If we don't have a problem, we don't need a miracle.
Yep, right.
But God's not in the problem business. He's in the miracle working business. Yes. Amen. The problems we have in this world, you'll have tribulation. Some of it's the devil. Some of it's just the world we live in. But God works miracles because of the problems. Amen. Nothing miraculous has ever happened to anybody that didn't start with a problem that needed to be fixed or transformed, including our salvation. Praise the Lord. God is God even in our problems, especially in our problems, even when we don't get what he's doing. As Tim said, we want immediate answers, and we want answers our way, the way we think they ought to come out. Listen, God's bigger than us. He knows more than us. Amen? He is there whenever we're going through a problem. And when we don't get what he's doing, it doesn't mean he's not doing something. It just means we don't understand what it is he's doing at the moment. Amen? Let's look at Ephesians 2 this time. Ephesians 2, verses 11 through 13. Wherefore, remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. We had a big problem. And God shows up with a miracle. Before we knew God, before we even wanted God. We didn't know what the answer to all of our problems were until the miracle showed up. Jesus. Amen? Jesus, he drove his disciples crazy, if you think about it. They knew what he ought to do, but he rarely did what they thought he ought to do. He'd do something else, and it would make them go nuts. You know, he's wanting to go into Israel. They're saying, they're trying to kill you there. You don't want to go there. We need to stay away from there. And he said, we need to go while the sun shines. Amen? You know, there's going to be darkness, and there'll be plenty of time for fear and anxiety and all that stuff. But right now, we need to be moving on into this situation, because he knew what his agenda was. They didn't.
Right.
They thought they knew what he was there for, but they didn't understand it. Right. They needed a miracle, and he was the miracle, and they didn't even acknowledge it. They didn't understand it. They wanted the miracle they wanted.
Right.
But he had the miracle they needed. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. John chapter 11, verse 1 through 6. So my words to myself and to anybody that's going through problems is, don't try to figure it out yourself. Just trust God. He knows what you need. You may think you know what you need, but I've had this experience in my own life, where I wanted certain things, and some of the things I wanted, I got, and I wished after I got them, I hadn't gotten them.
Right.
They became a bigger problem than a solution. Amen? I'm not talking about people now, but I'm talking about just things. You want certain, like Tim was saying, certain job. You get the job, and it's a nightmare.
Yeah.
It's not taking you anywhere. It's a bigger problem than it is a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a certain man was sick, named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. And it was that Mary, which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And when he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Now that doesn't make a whole lot of sense right there. But look at verse 14. Drop down to verse 14, if you will. Because his disciples were saying, if he's sick, we need to go. We need to go now, right? But he hangs out there for 2 more days. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. Which validated every weird thought they had, that they should have been moving. They should have been on their way at a dead run to get to Bethany because Lazarus was sick. Jesus waits 2 more days, and then he says, he's dead. Now, does that make any sense to you? I mean, forget that it's Jesus for a minute, because they weren't totally, they didn't have hindsight. They didn't have 2,000 years of history to go by that we have today. But just think about it in just natural terms. Does that make any sense?
No.
The guy that you love, the family that you're close to, he's sick. This is serious. And he waits 2 days until the guy's dead. Now, here's the thing. I've asked myself this. Is Jesus being difficult? And if he is, does God do the same thing today? He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. When it looks like there is a clear and an obvious solution to the problem, and we've got it figured out, why does God do something so different? Or seemingly nothing at all? John 11, verse 33. Jesus arrives, and when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping because of the death, they were all grieving, and which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. Jesus was God, but he was 100% human. He was feeling the pain. He was feeling their loss, their fear, their anxiety, they're grieving, the whole thing, right? Verse 38, drop down there. Jesus, therefore, again, groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. It was a cave, and the stone lay upon it. He's in this same, he's caught up in the emotions of the moment, because he's a man. Amen? God is unique, and he works uniquely. His ideas don't match our ideas. God rarely deals with our problems the way we would.
Right.
If God dealt with them the way we would deal with them, he wouldn't be any help to us.
Right?
Right? We think we know what we need to do, but if we could do it, we wouldn't be needing God.
Right.
Verse 39 and 40.
Jesus said, "Take me away the stone, Martha." Or taking away the stone, Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, "Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he hath been dead 4 days." Jesus saith unto her, "Said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God?"
Come on.
Verse 43.
And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth."
Take away the stone. Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus is now alive. He that was dead and rotting in the grave now walks out of the tomb in his grave clothes alive. God is unpredictable. And he works in strange ways. And the Bible is full of these kinds of testimonies for our benefit so that we can see God isn't going to do it your way. Rarely does he operate the way we operate. The way he does it always seems crazy to us.
Yep.
The resurrection of Lazarus, I mean, would any of us done it that way?
Nope.
He could have spoke the word when he was in the city that he was in without ever going to Bethany. Mm-hmm. And he'd have come out of that tomb, or he'd have never gone into it in the first place.
Right.
But he didn't. He had a purpose, a reason. And one of the reasons is so that we could look at this thousands of years later and say, God's got a better agenda than I've got.
He has
a better plan than I have.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen?
God can do anything.
Mm-hmm.
I want to rush there and get there before he dies and get him well. God's proven the point here that nothing is impossible with God. I'm not just a healer. I'm a resurrector.
Yes.
Amen? I give life. Praise God. So let's look at this in Genesis chapter 27, verse 12. Just another example of this. Now, Jacob, we know that his name means deceiver. And here he is trying to deceive. The only problem he's got is, like most criminals, he's not sorry that he's deceiving. He's sorry that he might get caught.
Yep.
Amen? So he says, "My father peradventure will feel me, and I shall seem to him as a deceiver. And I shall bring a curse upon me and not a blessing."
Mm-hmm.
So it isn't that he's willing to cheat his father and his brother out of his birthright in a legal sense, but it's that he's afraid he'll get caught, and the result won't be the blessing. The result will be he'll be cursed because of it. All right, Genesis chapter 32, verse 28. And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed.
Yes.
So from the deceiver, which he was, God declares him Israel.
Yes.
A prince, someone who has relationship with God, somebody who has influence with God.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
Jacob, we know leading up to this, he wrestled with God and he gets up with a limp.
Yep.
God didn't give Jacob the limp for punishment, but he gave Jacob the limp so that his confidence wouldn't any longer be in Jacob,
right,
but in God. His weakness would now make him dependent on the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. What we see as our weaknesses, God's trying to tell us that just might be your strength.
Amen.
It'll make you depend on me, mm-hmm, instead of the arm of the flesh. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. I wonder what Mary and Martha thought when Jesus showed up late after their brother died. It wasn't simple. It didn't make any sense. And we've got to learn to give God the benefit of the doubt. Maybe God can see my problem better than I can. Maybe God knows a little more than I know. Let's go back to Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 2, Roberto. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus and to the faithful in Christ, grace be to you and peace. You see that over and over in Paul's writings, the epistles that Paul wrote. It's grace to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Amen. Grace and peace. That's God's prescription for how the problems of life can be transformed.
Yes.
Grace and peace. Grace is undeserved favor, an undeserved gift. Peace is the result of redemption or restoration. So it's an undeserved gift with redemptive or restoration. It's a joining of whatever was separated or broken,
mm-hmm,
put back together.
Amen.
That's a combination that every one of us need. If not today, you'll need it sometime before your life is over,
amen,
I promise you.
Amen.
It's always grace and peace. It's not peace and grace.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not an accident. Peace has no chance unless grace comes first.
Amen. Amen.
It goes all the way back to Jesus coming in the first place.
Yes.
Salvation is a gift of grace, and we'll never know peace without it. You can't have peace without grace first.
Amen.
Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Grace, then, isn't just a gift that we receive for no reason. It's a gift that we receive because it then shuts our mouth, so there's no credit that we can take for it. No bragging on our part.
Amen.
And as a result of that, we can get down living in the gift of grace, and peace comes as a result of that.
Mm-hmm.
Peace is only possible because of grace. And that forces us to have confidence in God,
mm-hmm,
and not in ourselves.
Amen.
The gospel is good news.
Yes.
And the good news is not that Jesus makes bad people good, And not that Jesus makes decent people or moral people better. The good news isn't that Jesus takes rebels and failures and does a makeover on them. The good news is Jesus makes dead people alive.
Yes. Amen. That's good.
The good news is Jesus makes weak people strong.
Thank you, Lord.
Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. He made us who were dead to God, alive to God, connected to God. Now look at this in Isaiah. This will be the last scripture. Isaiah 35, verse 3 through 10. This ought to be a life scripture for all of us. Isaiah 35, 3 through 10. Strengthen ye the weak hands and confirm the feeble knees. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, even God with a recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and streams in the desert. And the parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. In the habitation of dragons, where each leg shall be grass with reeds and rushes. And a highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it. But it shall be for those, the wayfaring men, though fools, shall not err therein. No lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereon. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away.
Yes.
So whatever seems dead in your life, there's resurrection. That's what he's telling us. Whatever your limp, there's a new identity. There's a strength that comes only from God. Whatever the problem, there's Jesus.
Amen.
Grace and peace.
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand. Praise God.
Lord.
Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. God bless all of you again for being here tonight. Appreciate your sharing your testimonies and prayers. And hope to see you back here Sunday. God bless you. All dismissed in Jesus' name. No matter the problem, God's bigger.